بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا أما بعد My dear brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته So alhamdulillah, tonight we have a very special guest, a very dear and close friend of mine, Sheikh Daood Butt. He's here with Al-Kawthar Institute. And I wanted to give a small introduction. You know, a lot of the times when you meet speakers, you only get to know their academic sides, where they studied, what they studied, who they studied with. But you don't get to hear some of the crazy things that happen during the process of studying. So I was thinking about, you know, stories that happened between Sheikh Daood and I while we were in Medina. And I came up with, you know, one good story, one mediocre story, and one really bad story. So let's start off with the good story first. The good story first, alhamdulillah, when Sheikh Daood and I met in Medina, he, for some reason, got his driver's license there very quickly. I can't remember why that happened, but it took me a very long time for me to get my driver's license while we were there. Now, one of the advantages of Sheikh Daood having a driver's license is we would make these express Umrah trips. Literally, Umrah in 24 hours. We'd leave, you know, Wednesday after school, go make Umrah and come back and you're back by like Thursday night. And that's something that I really miss. Like now if you think about making Umrah, it's like you need to plan for like 5 months in advance, get your visas, get your tickets, book your hotels, find a reliable travel agent, and all of these issues. So I was thinking today, subhanAllah, you know, I wish that today when he arrived, we have this free time till tomorrow, only if we could go and make like an express Umrah trip like we used to. Now here's the middle story. Not good, not too bad. I don't remember what exactly happened or why this was going on, but myself, Sheikh Daood and Sheikh Muslih, we were together and we were on our way to Sheikh Yasir Qadi's house and we're in the elevator. And then for some reason, Sheikh Muslih, he decides to joke around in the elevator. So he starts jumping or bumping the elevator wall. And what happens? You know that the elevators in Saudi Arabia are not reliable whatsoever. The elevator freezes. It stops. And it's like the alarm button isn't working. That phone that they have for emergency, it's out of service. And we're like, what are we going to do? Alhamdulillah, by that time we had cell phone service. So I called Sheikh Yasir Qadi. Sheikh Yasir Qadi had to call like the landlord of the building. Then the janitor needed to come. And you know, we were stuck inside the elevator until we eventually got out and we were like the fiasco of the night, subhanAllah. Now the third story, this is the terrible story. So one of the advantages, one of the advantages of studying together is that you also get to travel together quite a bit. And leaving Medina during the summertime or even during like winter vacation, it's such a happy moment that people will not understand. Like a lot of people when they go to Medina, like why would you want to leave Medina, right? But when you left your wife and kids behind, you've left your parents behind, you've left so many luxuries behind, coming back to Canada was like, you know, the best thing that you could hope for during that time. So in one of those instances, we are on our way to the airport. And Medina airport, it's very circular in nature, the drop-off area. So the taxi driver drops us off and our luggage is in the back and our laptop bags are in the front. And I tell Sheikh Daood, look, I'll get the big bags from the back, you grab the laptop bags from the middle. And Sheikh Daood, he went to pay the taxi driver. I got the luggage out from the back and, you know, the taxi driver starts to drive off. What happens during this time is that we realize he's taken off with our laptop bags. Now, why is that significant? Because both of our passports are inside of our laptop bags. And you can imagine being stuck in the middle of Saudi Arabia without a passport. And the university is closed during that time. The embassy is probably closed during that time. It was like an absolute nightmare. And we're like, okay, let's come up with a plan. And I'm like, look, I'll wait over here. And you run after the taxi. And because it's circular in nature, Sheikh Daood cut through the circle and he's running after the taxi. And, you know, at that time, I'm like, you know, why is this happening? What sin did we commit that Allah's punishing us like this? So a couple of minutes, I would say 10, 15 minutes go by. I don't see Sheikh Daood. I don't see the taxi driver. And I'm like, khalas, this is it. You know, this is the end of our journey. I'm getting ready to spend the summer here in Medina. But I eventually see him coming back And he's walking back, and I'm like, why is this guy walking back? Hurry up, run back. And then he comes back and he's like, you know, I got to the light, I caught up with him, but you know, the taxi driver took off. And I was like, inshallah khair, you know, at least we have each other for the summer now. But alhamdulillah, you know, after like, this might have been possibly the most sincere dua I've ever made in my life, you know, possibly, very possibly. And this guy, you know, he has two laptops, two Canadian passports, a whole bunch of money, I'm assuming close to like $1,000, all in our laptop X. But this nice, generous, genuine individual, mashallah, he drives back to the airport and returns our laptop bags to us. And that was like a, you know, a shocking moment as well. That seldom anywhere in the world would you find such, you know, nice, genuine individual that fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah, that will return two laptop bags with money and Canadian passports in it. So these are just some of the many adventures that Sheikh Daood and I had in Medina. Alhamdulillah, it's a pleasure and an honor to be able to host him here in Calgary tonight and throughout the rest of the weekend. Tonight he's going to be presenting on the all-arounder, the all-around perfect characteristics of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So without further ado, I present to you Sheikh Daood Bhatt.
Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Innal hamdalillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruh. ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. My brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Once again, my version to these three stories differs slightly because I was running and getting going after the taxi driver, mashallah. But subhanallah, you know, before I get into our topic, Sheikh Naveed and I have been through a lot more than just that. And subhanallah, I was telling Brother Adnan today about the Umrah trips. Going for Umrah. In fact, you were sleeping the whole way. I was the one driving. So we didn't get back on Thursday nights. We got back Thursday morning just after Fajr. MashaAllah, it was like, go and come back. But he kept me company. I could talk to him and he would just, and he was sleeping. Alhamdulillah. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests us with many things. And in that last story that Sheikh Naveed mentioned, when I was coming back, I had actually jumped, I ran across the parking lot, couldn't catch up to him, jumped into another taxi and told the driver, I'll pay you whatever it takes, just go after that taxi there. So he starts driving and it's this really old Bedouin man. And he's like, Bismillah. He's like, the gear's not going in. And I'm like, hey, atfaddal, go quickly. I'll go, he has my passport. He's like, khair, khair. He's like, and I'm like, he's driving like 10 kilometers an hour. And I'm like, he's gone, you know. SubhanAllah. And I came back. I was literally in tears. Because not only was my laptop in there, you know, I had only my cell phone on me. My passport, my wallet, my laptop, everything that was important, my ticket was inside that bag. And for the 7.5 years that I studied in Medina, my wife stayed in Canada. So I was thinking, that's it. You know, I waited 10 months to see my wife and it just went down the drain. And subhanAllah, this brother, when he came back, like we were sitting on the steps of the airport. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, when He wants something for you, He gives it to you. For those of you that were at the khutbah today, this ties in with it, right? وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا. This man, he came back, he said, you know, I stopped to pick up two other passengers, and when I looked in the back as they were opening the door, I realized that your bags were sitting there. So I told the passengers, get out, get out, I need to go back to the airport. There's, you know, these people left their bag. And so he came back to the airport, he had his hazard lights on. And we're sitting there like, I'm literally in tears. Right, and Sheikh Naveed standing there thinking, what are we gonna do? Like, I remember he's just like, what just happened? You know, it's like, what just happened to us? And subhanAllah, he comes back and we both literally ran to him and gave him hugs like he was our father, you know. We just both were hugging him at the same time. And we're like, Jazakallahu khairan, what do you need? I'm like, tell me, I have my bank card, I'll go to the bank machine and take out, how much money do you want? You know, I'll go get it and I'll give it to you. He's like, you guys are travelers, just make dua for me when the plane takes off. And that was it. He just turned and walked away. And subhanAllah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows us that, you know, as Sheikh Naveed mentioned, there are some really sincere people out there whose hearts are pure and who want to only please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's it. You know, this man could have really like done well with what he had there, but subhanAllah, he didn't. Our topic today, inshaAllah ta'ala, we'll get into it, is the all-rounder. How the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a unique yet adaptable individual, in the sense that he dealt with people that were poor. He dealt with people that were rich. He dealt with nobility, right? With royalty. He dealt with leaders of other nations. He dealt with people that loved him and he loved them. He dealt with people that hated him, right? And how he dealt with that in reaction, we'll look at inshaAllah ta'ala. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was an individual who, in every single aspect of our life, in every situation, even the situation right now that we are sitting in, we can learn from him. So for example, just off the top of my head, you know, someone walks through the door and sees a halaqah going on. They can either sit at the back, come through the middle, or come to the front. We know that this is a hadith that happened and three companions came in and that was the situation. So every situation that we are faced with, we can learn something by tying it back in with the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Anbiya about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking to or addressing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he tells him, we have sent you not but for a mercy to all of mankind. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. That you are a mercy for all of mankind, right? Al-alameen here doesn't just mean mankind as in human beings, right? It also means the jinn. Human beings, the jinn, and everything that exists. And we see that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam literally was rahmatan lil-alameen. Even when it came to moving a stone, he would not move it unless there was a need to move it. When it came to taking something off a tree, was that something that he did or not? Right? When it came to eating certain foods or eating amounts of foods, right? And respecting the animals, respecting nature, respecting the ground, respecting the body, the human body. He was rahmatan lil'alameen, right? He was the person who showed us how to deal with every single situation. And we're going to, inshaAllah ta'ala, just point out a few of these tonight. We obviously can't go through every aspect of his life and all the different ways and the different methods used by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but we'll go through a good number insha'Allah ta'ala. Now, because someone is sent to all of mankind, or as a mercy to all of mankind, we could say, that doesn't mean that everyone is going to like him, right? And we know that not everybody liked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Muslimin were close to him, the Mushrikeen fought against him, right? Even though he was sent as someone to guide them, to help them, to show them what is best for them, they didn't like him. They didn't like his way. Or maybe some of them liked him, but didn't like what he was preaching, didn't like what he was calling towards. Right? So, you and I, in our life, don't think that even though you learn from the lessons of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that everyone is going to accept you. Don't ever feel that you're going to be accepted 100%. Because if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent as a mercy to all that exists, and still people did not accept him, then you and I will not be accepted fully. And the reason why I say this is, for example, simple example, I'm delivering this halaqa, this lecture right now. Some of you will agree with certain things that I'm saying and the way that I maybe deliver it, or the way that I speak, the way that I present it, and some won't. And we have this qa'ida amongst, you know, a lot of the speakers, when they get together, they talk and discuss things. And it's a general qaida, Sheikh Naveed knows, right? About 80% of the people will understand, accept, and feel good with what you're saying. And maybe 10 to 20% will just say, you know what, this is just bogus, this is ridiculous, or I don't agree, or you know what he's saying doesn't make sense, and so on and so forth. So you'll never please everyone. And that's the point, not to please people. The point is to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you please Allah, those that are pleased with what you're saying and doing will be pleased, right? And those that are not pleased, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is still pleased with what you're doing. So you're pleasing Allah when the people are pleased, because you're pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And even when you're displeasing certain people, or people are displeased with what you're saying and doing, even though you are trying your best to do the best according to the sunnah and the sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even if they're displeased with it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with you because you did your best trying to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and not trying to please the people. So that is the first example for us. How do we assist our own selves in pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and disregarding whether people like it or not? Yes, when someone has an issue with what you say or do, you have to accept it and take it and try and learn from it, right? And this is the method of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Someone didn't like his message that he was, you know, coming to them with, they would tell him, they would explain it to him, they would express that to him, right? And not go behind and talk to others about it. They would bring it to his attention. In a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned in Abu Dawood, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "If there is any man from my nation that I have cursed or said something bad out of anger towards, then that is because I am from the children of Adam." Right? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is telling us this, and he says, "I am from the children of Adam. I become angry just like the children of Adam became angry." Right? So we are not always perfect human beings. The way that we deal with people in the situations that we're faced with is going to differ. Sometimes we do the greatest thing according to our knowledge Islamically, and other times we might make a mistake. So this lecture tonight, I hope you know those that do the halaqa after me maybe can talk about the methods of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in correcting people. So how to correct people's mistakes. This is a very important topic to learn about, but we don't have time for that tonight, inshaAllah ta'ala. The mercy of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he had towards his enemies. Okay, let's look at this next step. What type of behavior did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam have towards his enemies? Now, when we say enemies, the first thing that probably pops into our head is the battlefield. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the companions radiallahu anhum are on the battlefield and they're fighting against the enemies, right? But even on the battlefield, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught the companions how to have mercy against their enemy. So the methods in fighting, right? The ways in doing that was something that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam showed them and taught them. Also, we learn from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's life that limits were not transgressed. So people were respected. So for example, women, children, religious people, religious places, these were things that the Prophet ﷺ did not just go in and destroy. Right? He did not do this. And this is very important for us to know today, because obviously what things are happening around the world, right? We see that these sort of topics are in you know, current events. So the Prophet ﷺ in his method in dealing with the enemies was a just and also at times when it was off the battlefield, a very calm, very respectful type of behavior, right? And let's take examples of that, inshaAllah ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when he would go into certain lands, so let's say they conquered lands or they were, you know, traveling and there was a battle that took place. Did they destroy the trees? Did they destroy the wells? Did they destroy the places of worship? Did they destroy other things amongst them? No, they didn't, right? They still respected the children. They respected the elderly. They respected the religious people of other religions, right? The religious people of other religions. Because those religious people normally would not show up on the battlefield, right? Even in Islam, when the Prophet ﷺ went out, you'll notice that those that were needed to stay behind to help out were told to stay behind. Yes, we see that Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman and all those companions of the Prophet ﷺ went out. But when there was a specific need for someone to stay behind, they remained behind. And Islamically, we see that the scholars, they are the ones that have the knowledge, they protect the knowledge, and so they're usually the ones that will stay behind. So out of respect in dealing with others, the Prophet ﷺ would have that sort of behavior. Also, when we look at the example of the Prophet ﷺ, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the angel of the mountains, right, to come and destroy, and he approached the Prophet ﷺ and asked him, do you want me to destroy, take these two mountains and just crush the people of Mecca? Now this is when he came back from Ta'if. Do you want me to crush them? Just take these two mountains and destroy the people. And the Prophet ﷺ, even though he was being stoned and blood was flowing from his body, and we know that his footwear was clogged to his feet, what did he say in response? The Prophet ﷺ told the angel, no. No. Rather, I hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring out from the progeny, from the descendants of those people that were harming him, the mushrikeen. He said, I hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make from the descendants of those people, those who worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Subhanallah. Listen to that. He wishes that, or he has hope that from the descendants of his enemies are people who worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I use this example a lot. If someone that, you know, the whole world looks at and says, oh, you know, this person is an oppressor. If they were to come in and sit right here in front of us right now, how would you feel? Right? We could say, how would you react? Or we could say, how would you want to react? But you wouldn't do it, right? You'd probably say, oh, this is an oppressor. Whatever person. You picture whichever person you want in your head. And that person walks through the door right now and sits right in the front. What would you do? How would you behave towards this person? They just came into the masjid and sat down in the front. Even though they're in the masjid, some people would probably get fired up and say, no, get out, and start shouting and yelling, right? And we see this sometimes in our masajid, hopefully not here in Calgary, but in Montreal, we see it all the time. People shouting and yelling and fighting with one another. Oh, get out, you don't belong here, right? Telling people, just get out. But this is the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, firstly. Secondly, if the person comes to learn something, maybe that person who was an oppressor becomes someone that is good towards the deen. Look at Hind. Today we say Hind radiallahu anha, right? What did she do with the liver of the beloved uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? What did she do in the battle of Uhud, at the end of the battle? Hamza, she had someone hired as an assassinator to go and make sure that he killed the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then she cut open his chest, took out his liver, and started to chew and eat on the liver. But today we say, radiallahu anha. Amazing, isn't it? When she came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ready to accept Islam, did he turn to her and say, get out, right? Did he shout at her, get out, no, you don't belong here, go. No, he didn't. So the Prophet ﷺ was rahmatan lil alameen. We need to learn from the examples of the Prophet ﷺ. In dealing with the Muslimin, in dealing with the non-Muslims, we live in an area where we are minority, even though we're a large community, mashallah, we're still minority, right? Even though we're born here, I myself am born here, right? Born and raised in this country, in Canada, in Montreal. This is my country, and I say that this is my country. And when someone comes and tells me, especially in Quebec, when they tell me in French, go back to your country, I look at them and I say, I don't have another country to go to. This is my country. I have one passport, one nationality, one citizenship. This is my country. And usually in Quebec, they speak to you in French. And so I respond to them and say, je suis Québécois. right? And I tell them straight in French, because I speak French, that this is my country, and this is where I belong, and this is who I am. I'm a product of your society, right? And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to seek nearness to Him by pleasing Him in ways that are pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and showing mercy to others, right? This is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Let's move on. The way or the method that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wanted goodness for people of all faiths. So if someone was of a different religion, for example, living among the Muslimin. So this is someone who is, for example, a Jewish or a Christian, right? Who is living amongst the Muslimin. How did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam treat them? Did he go and destroy the house? Did he, you know, just like throw garbage on their property? I remember our teacher in Montreal, right? My teacher growing up, I learned something really good from him, it still stuck with me. He used to take out the garbage of his neighbors. The person that lived on the right and the left side of him, on the garbage collection day, he would go out early in the morning because we wake up for Fajr, right? So he would go to the masjid for Fajr. On his way back from Fajr, the neighbors would still be sleeping. He would go to their backyards and pull out the garbage containers to the front of the road. And I used to go to his house and sleep over when I was young, right? And I asked him, like, why do you do that? It's freezing cold, you're wasting your time taking the neighbor's garbage out. He says the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even when he was being harmed, he was still kind towards others, right? Yes, there's a difference between battlefield, and we leave the battlefield aside. Why do I leave the battlefield aside? Are we in the battlefield right now? No, we're not. Probably, maybe for our entire life, we wouldn't be. From the time I was born until now, I've never seen a battlefield, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best what's in our future, right? But we live amongst people who we need to show an example to. And if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was mercy for everyone, then why should we not be merciful upon them? They are our neighbors. And we should treat our neighbors how we expect to be treated by our neighbors. So the next time we complain that our neighbors have, you know, maybe racial sort of behavior towards us or treat us as though we're second class citizens, we should treat them even better. We should treat them even better. Because we love for our brothers, yes, in Islam, what we love for ourselves, but we also want to show an example of Islam to others so that they can respect us back. And this is the way of the Prophet ﷺ. How the Prophet ﷺ was mercy towards the believers, right? Towards the Muslimin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مِّنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ عَزِيزٌ عَلَيْهِ مَا عَنِتُّمْ حَرِيصٌ عَلَيْكُمْ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَؤُوفٌ رَحِيمٌ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Tawbah, that verily there has come unto you a messenger from amongst yourselves. So this is obviously for the Muslimin at that time, right? But also from amongst us, right? From amongst us as an ummah, one of us, which was a Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was chosen to be the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It grieves him, meaning it grieves the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, it grieves him that you should receive any injury or difficulty. So it hurt the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he saw the Muslimins being hurt. He was hurt. And he is anxious over you for the believers. He is full of pity, kind, and he's merciful. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam felt for us and he felt what we felt. So when you feel hurt, know that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam felt hurt when the Muslimin felt hurt. But now let's look at our reaction. When things happen around the world against the Muslimin, and we see the way that people react,
right?
We see the way that they react towards those that are speaking against the Muslimin, for example. Would the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam approve of our method in dealing with people? Would he approve with our method in dealing with people? When we speak to people, do we speak to them kindly? Do we say our please and thank you like our parents teach us to do? Or do we speak to them as though they're the second class citizens and we have a right? Because when we do that, we are showing pride and a little bit of arrogance. That yes, I have a right. Yes, you do have a right. But you need to show respect back. Why? Because the Prophet ﷺ, when his feet were clogged to his footwear, did he turn around and tell the angels, just destroy them? Did he pick up a stone and throw it back at them? Did he go and burn flags? Did he take books and light them on fire? Or take pictures of people and stomp on them with his feet? Did he do things like this? Would he have done things like that? The Prophet ﷺ used methods in showing others that Islam was the right way. And even when there was a janaza, a funeral procession of someone that was not Muslim, the Prophet ﷺ would stand up out of respect for that person, meaning the dead body. And this is an example that we show respect. Yes, someone from amongst you has passed away, but it also shows us as Muslimin that we didn't do our part. That is a person who died outside of Islam. And we maybe could have contributed to that. Yes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the one who guides who He wills, as we said at the very beginning. At the very, very beginning and almost the beginning of every single khutbah and lecture, the imam, the khatib, whoever will start and say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides who He wills, and those that are misguided, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will misguide them, right? So, when we talk about showing an example to others, yes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides who He wills, but did you do your part? That's the question. When you know people around you that passed away, that whether they were Muslim or non-Muslim, and you dealt with them, you interacted with them, they may have been your relatives. I have relatives that are non-Muslim. My mom accepted Islam, her whole side of the family is Roman Catholic. I know very well that I will be questioned about that. So am I doing enough to speak to them, to encourage them, to show them, not so much speaking, but to show them the example of Islam in my actions, in my dealings with them, in the way that I react when they say something like, man, you guys pray too much, right? Or you guys are so picky, there's too many rules. You have to eat this, has to be halal, it's got to be, too many rules. Chicken is chicken, beef is beef, just eat it, right? How do you react to the way that you're spoken to? And sometimes it doesn't even take speech. And we see this in the example of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. When he was walking back and holding the provisions of an elderly woman, right? And she had provisions, so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam went to her and asked, can I help you? And she gave him the stuff and he was carrying it back to her home. And the whole way, she is bad talking the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The whole way, she's saying, be careful. She doesn't even know that it's him. She's saying, be careful of the man named Muhammad. He's a magician. He's a soothsayer. He's an evil person. He's spreading lies. He's a poet, right? He speaks very eloquently. He's tricking people. Be careful of him. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, is he saying, no, he's not. What are you talking about? You don't know what you're talking about. You're crazy. You're an old lady. Is he saying that? No, he's not. Sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He's remaining completely silent. Completely silent. This is a prime example that I use all the time to show people that a lot of the time, actions speak louder than words. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam reached her home, put the provisions down for her, and then he's about to leave and she asks, what's your name? I didn't even ask your name. What's your name? And he says, I'm Muhammad. Whoa, what just happened? right? What just happened? The Prophet ﷺ is hearing this lady bad talk Muhammad the whole way home. She gets home, he puts her stuff down, she's happy, she's pleased, oh, this young man, he helped me, right? And subhanAllah, he says, that's him. The man that you were talking about the whole way, that's him. What does she say? Does she start to say, ah, oh, get out of here, you know, start, you know, refuting, you know, his help or refusing his help and stuff like that? Does she say anything in return? She says, you, that's you? Yes, that's him, right? He acknowledges that that's him. And on the spot, she accepts Islam. On the spot, she says, أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِنَّ اللَّهِ وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَا وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّكَ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. Amazing. The Prophet ﷺ didn't have to say anything. Absolutely nothing. Absolutely nothing. So when you deal with people sometimes over the long run, they might not even know that you're a Muslim, because you might not show signs of Islam. Or you show signs of Islam to them, but they don't know that these are values and characteristics of Islam. So how do you plug, we should say, how do you plug Islam into the lives of others that are around you? Let's look at another example, insha'Allah ta'ala. The Prophet ﷺ at some times was more kind to the believers, to the Muslimin, than the parents of those Muslimin themselves. Sometimes those parents, a lot of the time, they were not even Muslim. So the Prophet ﷺ showed mercy to them, even more than their own parents showed mercy upon them. And we know, those of us that are parents, we know how much love we give to our children. When they're small and they have a cold, we stay awake at night watching them to make sure they're breathing. Make sure the chest is going up and down. They're breathing. And sometimes you have to, a busy day the next day at work, but you spend the whole night watching this newborn baby. Is the chest going up and down, up and down, up and down? The whole night. The child gets older, playing around, falls down, hits their head on the ground, cuts their head open, is bleeding. You leave everything. You might even leave your wallet, your laptop, whatever is in your hands, your phone. You might drop it, pick up your child, and rush to the hospital. Every single thing that you do in your life, when something happens to your child, you feel, subhanAllah, I need, you know, you just go. You drop everything and go. And the Prophet ﷺ treated the Muslimin better than that. Better than that. How do we treat someone better than that? That's where we learn from the example of the Prophet ﷺ. Let's take another example, insha'Allah ta'ala. Very quickly, the mercy of the Prophet ﷺ towards orphans. And not only orphans, we should tie it in with today as well. We don't see many orphans a lot of the time in the cities that we live in. But what about the homeless? What about the needy? What about those that make less? What about those that can't pay their rent? What about those that live in low-income housing? And we look at them and we say, mashallah, in Canada, you know, alhamdulillah, we have this welfare system, gives people low-income housing, right? And it's great. And we look at it from outside, we say, wow, the government gives people nice places to live. But sometimes those family members can't even afford to put food on the table. Maybe they don't even have a table to give food to their children in front of them. So they have four walls around them. And from the outside, we look at them and say, wow, mashallah, low-income earners, look at what they get, you know? They get everything. Alhamdulillah, life's good for them, right? And we're working hard at work, right? I'm not saying all of us, but sometimes this is the case. But within their houses, they might be struggling. So how much mercy do we have upon those? Do we go and visit our Muslim brothers and sisters that are living in such houses or apartments? Do we go and visit our Muslim and brothers that might be living in nice houses? Maybe they're struggling in other ways. Maybe they have family issues. Maybe they're too shy to come forward and speak to others about it. Sometimes you see your brother in the masjid or your sister in the masjid and you notice something is wrong. You can tell on their face, maybe they look extremely tired. Or they look as though, you know, life is just, subhanAllah, it's catching up to them. They're going through difficult times. Do you ever ask, can I help you? Is everything okay? If you need something, just let me know. Give them a hug, right? And just say, You know, if you ever need me, I'm always there for you. Give me a call anytime, day or night. I'm there. Do we do that? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, especially when he was dealing with orphans, he was an orphan himself. We today, I remember I went to an orphanage. I've been to quite a few orphanages. I was living in Malaysia for a number of years. A lot of orphanages out there. And I went to an orphanage once, and the people that came for us, that came with us, this was during Ramadan, and we went to feed the orphans. We went there to, you know, we had purchased some nice food for them to give to them during Ramadan. And some people were feeling like, you know what, these are orphans, they don't have parents, so they don't really shower very well. You know, their hair doesn't look like it's done properly. Maybe they have lice. Right, so people kept their distance from the children. They were there smiling and talking to them, but keeping their distance. What did the Prophet ﷺ used to do? We know that when he would see orphans, he would love to make them feel as though they were his own child. Right? They were his own children. He would pat them on the head, right? Playing with their head and their hair. Is he thinking of lice? SubhanAllah. Go wash your hand after, big deal, right? At our time, we have water and soap and disinfectant in our pockets and our bags. We could disinfect our hands anytime. Pat them on their head. Make them feel loved and welcomed. Make them feel as though, even though they don't have a father and sometimes don't even have a mother, that you are their mother and father. You are the one that's going to take care of them. You're going to be there for them when they get older, when they need your assistance. You're going to be there for them now when they don't have food in front of them to eat. You're going to take off your own jacket and give it to them. When the Prophet ﷺ would tell the companions to bring forward their wealth to give for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, did they go home and say, okay, I haven't worn this shirt in 6 months or a year. This one's a little bit torn, it's worn out, so let me, you know, get that one and give it away. Like we do today when we say, oh, give your clothing away to those that need it. We go and we look at our used stuff, what's really old and used. Do we take our newest things out and give that for the sake of pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Do we give the best of what we have for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Or do we give the used stuff that we don't really want, we're going to get rid of anyways? Look at the example of Qabil and Habil, right? Two brothers from Adam alayhi salam. What were they asked to do? Present a sacrifice. Bring something to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Qabil brought, you know, useless grain that was old. And what did Habil bring? Nice, good, beautiful animal. Presented it. This is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? Bringing it for the sake of pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And us today need to learn from that example as well. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even when his uncle Abu Talib, right, when he was at a little bit of an older age, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took Ali ibn Abi Talib, took him into his own house. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't have to look after him, but to relieve his uncle, who was not even a Muslim, who was not a mu'min, to relieve his uncle, to assist him and help him, the Prophet ﷺ looked after Ali himself. And we need to start doing this as well, brothers and sisters. We need to start looking after those that live in our community. You know a sister who's a single mother. Reach out. Have your wife reach out to that sister. How can we help you? What do you need? Are you having difficulty paying your rent? Are you having difficulty buying clothing? Winter's coming. Do your children have boots? Do your children have a hat? Do your children have a scarf and gloves and socks and a snowsuit? Do they have what they need to go to school? Do they have pencils and paper? Right? Are we asking those families that we know very well amongst us in our communities that need help? Are we helping them? They may not even be orphan children. But the Prophet ﷺ shows us the example of رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. Are we doing that? Are we living up to the name of the Prophet ﷺ? Are we living up to the example of the Prophet ﷺ? If we want to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we want Jannah, do you think it's going to come at an easy cost, an easy price? You must work hard. We must strive as hard as we can, thinking outside of the box. Thinking outside of the box, brothers and sisters. Be wise, be clever, be smart. Deal with people in a way that is just and honest. And I'm not saying when someone steps on your toes that you don't have any rights. No, you have rights. You have rights as a human being. You have rights as a citizen of the country you're living in. You have rights as a Muslim. You have many different kinds of rights, right? I remember just an hour ago, I was posting something online, and I noticed on Twitter a police officer in our community in Mississauga had posted a picture of a dog, the head of the dog that someone had either beaten or hurt somehow, I don't know what it was, but it was a picture, and it said, the person who did this needs to be prosecuted to the max. And this is a dog. Are we the type of people that look after the human beings, the nature around us, even the animals that we see in front of us? Lastly, I want to take the example where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there's a number of things I wanted to get into, like, you know, helping the prisoners, those that were put in prison unjustly in different parts of the world, maybe, you know, we can help them and assist them in certain ways, providing them whatever, assistance in the justice system that we can. For those that are sick, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam showed us there are 6 rights, for example, that a Muslim has over another Muslim. The first being greetings. When someone says assalamu alaikum, do you respond to their salam? And do you respond in the method of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam by saying equal to that or more? So a person says assalamu alaikum, you say wa alaikum assalam. But what's encouraged is to say more. Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh. Right? Also, a right of a Muslim upon us, when they invite us for something, we must accept that invitation. Of course, if we have something already scheduled at that time, or there's already something going on, that's a different story. Another right of a Muslim upon us, when they seek your advice, give them the advice that they need. Don't give them the advice that they want. This is our mistake. When someone comes to us for advice, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would give advice to that person, the advice that they need, not the advice that they want. Meaning, be just, be honest in the advice that you give. Someone is wrong, don't be shy to tell them you're wrong in this case. What you should have done or what you should do now is XYZ. So be just, be honest in the way that you give advice and give advice to others that they need. Remember that always, and not advice that they want. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also says, with regards to the rights of a Muslim upon another, when they sneeze and they praise Allah, respond to that as well. So someone says alhamdulillah after sneezing, say yarhamukallah, right? When the next right is, when a person is sick, visit them, and when a person dies, follow the funeral procession. How many times do we visit the sick? How many times have we gone to the hospital this year, randomly, without going because we are sick? We randomly go to the hospital for no absolute reason. Even though parking might be very expensive at the hospital, go. Because your reward while visiting someone that is sick, in another hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says in Sahih Muslim, whoever visits a sick person remains among the khurfa of paradise until he returns. And what is this? The scholars say that it is the fruits of paradise, meaning it's a metaphor. You are earning the reward of paradise until you return. You're earning the reward of paradise from the time that you're gone to visit someone who's sick until the time that they return. Would we not want paradise? How many times do we go out of our way when we're driving down the street and we see the hospital, like, may Allah save us from this place, right? But we should turn our indicator on, turn the car into the parking lot, go inside, and just walk through. Whether we see a Muslim or a non-Muslim, irrelevant. You see someone who's sick, a patient, sit with them, talk to them, encourage them. Especially patients that are extremely sick, about to die. You might go to them, they have no family members. Many times you see people who are elderly in these countries even more so. When children get older, they put their parents in old folks' home, right? So when they get sick and they're in the hospital, where are the children? Oh, I'm too busy at work. So these parents who are elderly, grandparents in the hospital, no one's visiting them. You walk in, you see them, you speak to them, you smile at them. They become curious. Why did you come and visit me? You didn't have to say anything about Islam. They're asking you, why did you come and visit me? I'm some random patient in the hospital. What made you come to me today? You tell them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made me come to you today. It is from the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I turned into this hospital. He wanted me to come here. He wanted me to visit you. And I'm fulfilling a right that I have upon you. If they're a Muslim, this is a right that they have upon you. And in the time that I'm here, I'm earning my Jannah. Subhanallah. Amazing. Amazing opportunity that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us. And it's free. It's a free opportunity. A free road to Jannah. But are we taking this? Lastly, brothers and sisters, I mentioned the example of the dog, the animal. Famous hadith that we all know, mentioned or reported by Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells us about the adulteress, right? The adulteress who was forgiven. This is a woman who is committing illegal, according to Islam, illegal sexual acts. Someone who is committing a major sin comes back to their home and sees next to the well a dog who wants water. For their life, they want water. This dog is seeking life through this water. And this woman takes off her footwear, ties it to her scarf or her gown, and puts it down into the well, takes out the water from the well, and takes her footwear and puts it down in front of the dog and lets it drink out of it. The Prophet ﷺ says, as a result of that action, she was forgiven. As a result of that action, she was forgiven from an adulteress to being forgiven by giving a dog water to drink. Are we seeking the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, brothers and sisters, in the things that we have around us, right? Remember, if you were there for the khutbah today, remember what we talked about. Try and remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all the time by things that you see around you. Try to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in every situation that you're in. You might be late after salah and you're rushing out this door, but you see someone who comes and shakes your hand and gives you salam, the least you can do is respond to their salam and give them a smile. Because we know that the smile, the Prophet ﷺ teaches us, is sadaqah. So leave them with something good. Leave the masjid making someone else feel good. That they go home and they say, Subhanallah, I saw so-and-so person. They're telling their family, I met so-and-so person today. And they're happy to meet you. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make it easy for us to learn the methods of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in dealing with others in the situations that we're faced with, wherever we are on earth, whatever the case is, whoever approaches us, however they approach us. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us be the living, walking, talking example of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his method in pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa barak ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Questions? Three questions, inshallah. Yes.
Should we visit the sick people, non-Muslim sick people?
Should we visit non-Muslim sick people? Yes, we should.
Another thing is, should we make dua for them?
Should we make dua for them?
Yeah.
There's nothing wrong with making dua for someone who's a non-Muslim. You make dua that Allah guides them to Islam. You make dua that Allah opens their heart. You make dua for you, that Allah gives you the wisdom, the knowledge, and the ability and the hikmah in your speech, that your speech is accepted by that person. That sometimes you try and give da'wah to people. I know, because like I said, my family, a lot of them, they're not Muslim. The majority of my relatives are not Muslim. And when you speak to them, you want to make sure that your words are understood. So you make dua to Allah for you to be given the ability to convince them or to have an effect upon them in your words. So not only do you make dua for them, make dua for you to be effective upon them. So yes, it is something that is permissible and allowed. And yes, you should visit the non-Muslims, right? You should visit the non-Muslims as well. It is a right of a Muslim upon another Muslim. So if there's someone who's sick and you know that they're sick, you should go and visit them, right? You should go and take some time, or at least the least that you can do, I know we have a busy lifestyle, the least we should do is give them a phone call, right? Go and visit them if you can. Spend 2 minutes, 3 minutes, nothing long. If you're really busy, they will appreciate that time. It'll be more valuable than the possessions that they have in this world.
But So one of my friends told me that if someone is sick, non-Muslim people, we should not make dua for them for their shifa.
That makes no sense.
Your sheikh is answering for me.
I'll tell you one thing, and I apologize for including over here. When a non-Muslim sneezes, right, in Abu Dawud, Prophet was asked about a non-Muslim that sneezes, what do we say when a non-Muslim sneezes? The exact same thing that we would say for a Muslim, we say to a non-Muslim as well, with the exception of Yarhamukallah, but that second part when we say Yahdikum Allah wa yuslih badakum, it is legislated to say for the non-Muslim as well, that may Allah guide you and rectify your affairs. So the scholars of hadith, when they commented on this hadith, they said anything pertaining to the dunya, you're allowed for making for the disbeliever. And then as for the akhirah, the only thing you're allowed asking for him is guidance in this world. And after he passes away, then obviously the affair is over. So from this dunya, shifa is a part of it. You can definitely make dua for shifa. In fact, the Prophet ﷺ allowed ruqya being done with the Quran upon non-Muslims.
Yes.
Allahu Akbar.
Jazakallahu khair. Yes.
Yeah. Question. One of my friends from high school, we were close. Guy's not Muslim. He's getting married now. Is it halal to attend his wedding?
Okay, that's an interesting question. For those of you that didn't hear, the brother's saying a friend of his from high school is getting married, he's non-Muslim. Is it permissible to attend his wedding?
He's Jewish, though.
He's Jewish, okay. Do you meet this friend regularly?
Yes.
You meet him regularly?
Three times a week.
Okay. So what I would do is, like, I have non-Muslim family, right?
Yes.
And a lot of the time they invite us, actually they always invite us to the wedding, right?
Okay.
But I select where I will attend or which parts of the wedding I will attend, right? So for example, in order for me to keep or maintain family ties, I will go to the actual wedding ceremony,
okay. But
I won't go to the reception because there's a lot of drinking and alcohol, and I personally don't like to, whether they're family or not, I don't like to see people that are intoxicated,
yes.
Right? And mixing and dancing and so on and so forth. So I'll just attend for a short period of time to show myself to maintain family ties. Now this is someone who's not a family member. But at the same time, you hope and want goodness for them, right? So what I suggest for you is to at least attend a portion of his wedding to show yourself that you are maintaining your relationship with him. And you'll never know, because sometimes what happens is, if you don't go to his wedding, right, when you get married and you invite him to your wedding, you're like, just come, you know, it's fine, don't worry, you can sit at the back of the masjid, they're just going to sign the papers, just sit on a chair. He's going to say, well, you didn't come to my wedding.
Yeah.
Why should I go to yours?
I googled this and I got a bunch of responses.
Sheikh Google or Mufti Google, which one was it? The uncle or the nephew?
One of the responses was that hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Muslims have two eids, you know, and two celebrations, and
right.
No other celebrations are permitted. Does this not fall under this hadith?
So that means you can't attend even another Muslim celebration, wedding ceremony.
Okay.
Right?
Mm. Okay.
If you can't celebrate anything other than Eid, then you can't even celebrate a Muslim's wedding or your wedding. Right? Your wedding would have to be on the day of Eid. So
that's incorrect answer.
What I would suggest, look, I studied in the faculty of Da'wah and Usul al-Din.
No.
And so I studied how to deal with people and interact with people based on religions, religious interactions. I also studied the method in approaching certain situations. And I've had a lot of practical experience in that in my life as well. And I would encourage you to choose a portion or a time in that wedding where there's the least amount of fitna or the least amount of problems or sins that are committed, we could say, and go and show yourself, even if it's just for a small portion of time. Because he's a close friend of yours, it's a good means of da'wah. Trust me, it's something good. Okay? Then the decision is up to you.
One last question,
inshallah. Yes.
What about Qawwa
die? Sorry, what about what?
If Qawwa dies and he's not a Muslim.
A co-worker dies?
Yeah, you have to attend the Qawwa.
And they're not Muslim. Okay, out of respect, like we said, the Prophet ﷺ would sometimes see the funeral procession going by and he would stand up out of respect, right? Now, a lot of the time, the non-Muslims, right? I'm assuming this is non-Muslim, right? A lot of the time, non-Muslims, today, funerals vary from the sky to the core of the earth, right? They vary in different ways, different methods, cremation, and so on and so forth. My uncle recently died, my mom's brother, first one of our uncles to pass away, and he was cremated. And they sent us an invitation to attend the cremation. Why would I told my aunt, why would I go see my uncle being burnt? Why would I want to do that? I fear for him being burnt in the hereafter. Why would I want to go see him being burnt here? So a co-worker, for example, out of respect, you could maybe go and see some of the family members if you know the children or the spouse, right? Your family can go and visit them, for example, pay your respect to them, you know, and show that to them as an example that as Muslimin, we don't live in this world and just separate ourselves. We live on this side of the city, you live on that side of the city. We know that this is a big problem, right? And we cannot live together if we are always separating ourselves. So show yourself in a way that is best, that you feel is best. It might not be you actually attending that funeral, right? Or the burial, because there's so much shirk involved in it as well. They might call a priest, right? My uncle died immediately, minutes later, the hospital chaplain came and they said, we're gonna have a mass right there in the room around the dead body of my uncle. We're gonna have a mass, right? So these things are, there's shirk involved in it, right? So the best is, meet some of the relatives or family members, right? Maybe there's a wake, so you can go to the wake and just meet some of the families. You're not there to see his body or her body. You're there just to pay your respect to the family members and tell them that, you know, Allah loves you. Give them, always try and plug a message. I have this concept that I call plant the seed and let it grow. Plant the seed of Islam in people and leave them wondering. Don't go to people and say, Islam is this, Islam is that, Islam is this and that, and X, Y, Z, you know, A, B, C, all the way to Z. No. Leave them with something that they're going to start pondering. Ooh, why did they say that? God loves me and wants goodness for me, and I wish that you come closer to God, for example. They'll start to think, right? And you say this to them at a funeral or whatever the case is. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. I think that's all the time that we have. Jazakumullahu khairan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.